Hi, I'm Matt Gaunt, a developer advocate here at Google. We can all agree mobile is becoming more important and touchscreens are a common feature. So how can you implement touch in your web app? For me, touch support breaks down into these two key areas. First, you have the most basic way of responding to a user's touch by adding styles for states with the active and focus sudo class. Second, you have touch events to implement your own gestures. Let's start with the active and focus state. Whenever you're designing your site, you need to be thinking about the styling for the default, active, and focus states of your elements. Changing your UI with these styles stops the user from questioning if their touch has actually been acknowledged or not, and reduces the perceived latency of your web app. It makes your site feel snappy and responsive. By default, most browsers will add some kind of highlighting to elements. On the left is a slim orange focus ring added to a button, and on the right, you can see a blue tap highlight on an anchor tag. Now, personally, I hate it when my UI is altered with some random styling that doesn't fit in with my design. By adding an active and focus style, you get a much higher level of polish for your site. That's the most basic touch response. What if you wanted to implement a custom gesture? That's where we start to use touch events. If you've never played with touch events before, you need to register listeners for touch start, touch move, touch end, and touch cancel events. And these events will fire throughout the life cycle of a gesture. You'll see one touch start event followed by one or more touch move and a final touch end or touch cancel event at the end. The way you use this is super simple. Just get your element as usual with query selector or get element by ID. Add your event listeners with the event name and a callback function. And from this, you can use the event object, which is passed into the callback to get the X and Y coordinates out and then react to the gesture. Now, this is the rough outline of how everything fits together, but there are a few best practices you need to follow. Otherwise, you can really hurt your frames per second. The best practices we're going to cover are binding low and binding late, do as little as possible inside of the touch callbacks, which is always a good thing, and use request animation frames. So let's start with bind low and bind late. What bind low means is that you should bind your event listeners to the element you want the users to touch, rather than the entire document. The reason for this is that it helps the browser's performance, since the browser will only hop onto the main thread and execute JavaScript when a touch falls on an element with a listener, so the one you care about. Otherwise, if you add the touch event listeners to the document body, we're always going to execute JavaScript on the main thread, even though the touch may occur on an element we just simply don't care about. So, binding low means binding to the element itself. Binding late is referring to binding the touch move, touch end, and touch cancel event to the element as late as possible. So, in this example, we want all touch events to be handled by our swipeable boxes, or swipe me areas, when the touch starts happens inside one of them. For this, we add our touch move, touch end, and touch cancel events to the entire document body inside of our touch start event callback. Then, when we receive a touch end or touch cancel event, we remove all of the events from the document body. So we're binding as late as possible. You should check out the Show Potential Scroll Bottlenecks feature inside of Chrome DevTools, which is really helpful to ensure your logic is working as intended and helps highlight any potential problems. You can find it under the Rendering tab, which comes up when you hit the hamburger menu icon. That's bind low and bind late. The next thing you need to remember is to do as little as possible inside the touch callback. Why, I hear you ask? Because a callback is going to be running on the main thread. So if you do lots of work inside of it, you can really hurt your site's frame rate, which nobody wants. So always try to be as quick as possible inside the callback. But this raises the question of, if I get the touch's X and Y coordinates inside the event, how can I do anything with those values without blocking the main thread? And that's where Request Animation Frame comes in. Request Animation Frame is a technique of batching changes you want to make to the UI at a time that works with the browser rather than against it. You would call Request Animation Frame and pass in a function, which basically asks the browser to execute that function at a suitable point in its render loop. when the animation frame callback is executed, you can update the UI based on the last known touch event. So the overall flow is you request an animation frame, you wait while touch move events fire, and then when the browser is ready, it'll call your method and you can alter the UI. The important thing with this is that rather than change the element styles for every touch move, where you might see multiple events fire between render frames, you make changes based on the last known touch move, which is really the only important bit of work that needs to happen. So there we have it, touch on the web. The most basic way to respond to a user's touch with the active and focus sudo class, and if you want your own gestures, use of touch events. Check out the web fundamentals URL here for best practices, details on cross-browser implementation, so things like pointer events, and samples where you can steal some code. Cheers.